Hello everyone, today we will discuss about vitamin D. Vitamin D is a fat soluble vitamin. The inactive natural precursors of vitamin D are called provitamins. These are ergosterol and 7-dehydrocholesterol. Ergosterol is provitamin D2, that it is found in plants. It is provitamin D2. Then 7-dehydrocholesterol is provitamin D3 and is found in animal skin. All the provitamin D possess a certain essential structural characteristics. They contain a cyclopentanoperhydrophenandrin, then hydroxyl group at third position, then double bonds at the position between 5 and 6, then one more double bond between 7 and 8. Then a hydrocarbon chain at carbon 17. These are the structural characteristics. Then the transformation from inactive provitamin to the active vitamin is accomplished by UV rays. The photochemical activation, photolysis, results only in intramolecular rearrangements. We will see the conversion of provitamin D2 and D3 to vitamin D2 and D3. This is the conversion of provitamin to vitamins. That is ergosterol or provitamin D2 by photolysis UV rays, it is converted into ergocalciferol or it is called vitamin D2. Then 7-dehydrocholesterol, it is provitamin D3, then photolysis UV rays, it is converted into cholecalciferol or vitamin D3. Next we will see dietary sources of vitamin D. This is the structure of ergocalciferol or vitamin D2 and cholecalciferol or vitamin D3. Next we will see dietary sources of vitamin D. Dietary sources. Fish liver oil is the richest source of vitamin D. Fish liver oil is the richest source. Then egg yolk, margarine, lard also contain considerable quantity of vitamin D. Then some quantity is also present in butter and cheese. This ergosterol is widely distributed in plants. It is not absorbed well, so it is not of nutritional importance. Ergosterol, it is found in plants. It is not absorbed well. Then this calciferol is readily absorbed. 7-dehydrocholesterol is formed from cholesterol in the intestinal mucosa and principally liver, then passed on to the skin where it undergoes activation to vitamin D3 by the action of solar UV rays. That is a dietary source of vitamin D. Next we will see daily requirement. Daily requirement is 1 IU equals 0.025 mu g of vitamin D3. About 100 IU or 2.5 mu g of vitamin D is the daily requirement in adult. In adults, it is about 100 IU or equal to 2.5 mu g of vitamin D3. It is the daily requirement in adult. Then pregnant and lactating mother, then infants and children require about 220 IU per day. Vitamin D is easily supplied by cutaneous synthesis in sunlight in tropical countries. That is the daily requirement. Next we will see absorption and transport of vitamin D. Absorption and transport of vitamin D. Like other fat soluble vitamins, bile salts helps in the absorption of vitamin D. Bile salts help in the absorption. Then after absorption, it is carried in chylomicron droplets of the lymph in combination with serum globulin in blood plasma. So after absorption from this duodenum and jejunum, it is carried in chylomicron droplets of the lymph in combination with serum globulin in blood plasma. That is the absorption and transport. Next we will see biologically active form of vitamin D, that is called calcitriol. That is the biologically active form of vitamin D. It is otherwise called as calcitriol. We will see the formation of calcitriol. Calcitriol is the biologically active form. We will see the steps in the synthesis of calcitriol. First one is 7-dehydrocholesterol. It is provitamin D3 by UV rays. This first converted to vitamin D3, or it is called cholecalciferol. Cholecalciferol in, this is in liver. Next is vitamin D3 by the help of enzyme 25-hydroxylase. Then oxygen, NADPH and Mg++. It is converted to 25-hydroxy D3 or 25-hydroxycholecalciferol or calcidiol. Then from calcidiol, by the enzyme 1-alpha hydroxylase, and this is in kidney mitochondria, it uses NADPH, oxygen and Mg++. It is converted to 125-dihydroxy D3. It is otherwise called as calcitriol. This is the steps in the synthesis of calcitriol. The biologically active form of vitamin D is called calcitriol. It is the biologically active form. Biologically active form of vitamin D, which is synthesized in liver and kidneys. We will see the steps in the synthesis of calcitriol. First one is synthesis of 25-hydroxy D3 in liver. 25-hydroxy D3 in liver. It is otherwise called as calcidiol. Vitamin D2 and D3 binds to specific D binding protein. This vitamin D2 and D3 binds to specific D binding protein and is transported to liver. It is transported to liver. In liver, it undergoes hydroxylation at 25th position. At 25th position, it undergoes hydroxylation by the enzyme 25-hydroxylase and it forms 25-hydroxy D3. It is in the endoplasmic reticulum of mitochondria of liver cells. Then coenzyme or cofactors required are Mg++, NADPH and oxygen. A cytoplasmic factor is also required for this conversion. Two enzymes are also involved. They are NADPH dependent cytochrome P450 reductase and a cytochrome P450. These are the enzymes involved. The 25-hydroxy D3 or calcidiol is the major storage form of vitamin D. It is the major storage form. Major storage form of vitamin D in liver and found in circulation. The blood level of 25-hydroxy D3 exerts feedback inhibition of the enzyme 25-hydroxylase. The blood level of 25-hydroxy D3 or calcidiol exerts feedback inhibition on the enzyme 25-hydroxylase. So we got 25-hydroxy D3 or calcidiol. From this, the calcitriol is formed. Next, we will see the synthesis of 1,25-dihydroxy D3 or calcitriol. It is in kidneys. Synthesis of calcitriol takes place in liver and kidneys. So in the next step, 25-hydroxy D3 bound to specific vitamin D binding protein, and then from liver it is carried to kidneys. Then in kidneys, it undergoes hydroxylation at first position. At first position, it undergoes hydroxylation by the enzyme 1-alpha hydroxylase, and it forms 1,25-dihydroxyD3 or calcitriol. It is in endoplasmic reticulum of mitochondria of proximal convoluted tubules of kidney. The reaction is a complex three-component monooxygenase reaction requiring Mg++ oxygen and NADPH as the cofactors. In addition, at least three more enzymes are required. They are ferredoxin reductase, ferredoxin and cytochrome P450. This system produces 1,25-dihydroxyD3 or calcitriol. This calcitriol is the major potent metabolite of vitamin D. This is the most potent metabolite of vitamin D. Calcitriol is the major storage form of vitamin D. Calcitriol is the major potent metabolite of vitamin D. This is the steps in the synthesis of calcitriol. Next, we will see regulation of calcitriol synthesis. Regulation of calcitriol synthesis. Regulation of calcitriol synthesis is done by its own concentration. That means calcitriol's own concentration by feedback inhibition of the enzyme 1-alpha hydroxylase. It feedback inhibit the enzyme 1-alpha hydroxylase. Then next is by regulation by parathyroid hormone and by serum phosphate level. So by its own concentration, then parathyroid hormone and by serum phosphate levels. Hypocalcemia leads to marked increase in 1-alpha hydroxylase. Hypocalcemia leads to 1-alpha hydroxylase, increased level of 1-alpha hydroxylase activity. The effect requires this parathyroid hormone. Calcitriol regulates its own concentration. Since high levels of calcitriol inhibits the enzyme 1-alpha hydroxylase and stimulates the formation of 24,25-dihydroxyD3. So it forms 24,25-dihydroxyD3, which is not potent as calcitriol. So high levels of calcitriol inhibit the enzyme 1-alpha hydroxylase and stimulates the formation of 24,25-dihydroxyD3. This 24,25-dihydroxyD3 is not potent as that of calcitriol. Next, we will see mode of action of calcitriol. This is the regulation. Next one is mode of action. Mode of action of calcitriol. Calcitriol acts in a similar way as that of steroid hormone receptors. This binding is specific and reversible. The receptor has a specific binding site on DNA that contains zinc finger motif characteristic of other steroid hormones. Since calcitriol is synthesized in the body and acts like steroid hormone and has a basic sterol nucleus in its structure, it is regarded as a hormone. Calcitriol is regarded as a hormone and vitamin D as prohormone. Calcitriol is a hormone, is considered as a hormone, and vitamin D is considered as a prohormone. So the calcitriol is synthesized in the body and acts like steroid hormones, and this has a basic sterol nucleus in its structure. So it is considered as a hormone and vitamin D is considered as a prohormone. Structurally, this vitamin D and calcitriol have cyclopentano-perhydrophenandrin nucleus like a steroid hormone. The vitamin D or cholecalciferol is synthesized in human skin by UV irradiation from its precursor provitamin D3. From provitamin D3, this vitamin D or cholecalciferol is formed by the action of UV irradiation. Then vitamin D3 is inactive and is only the storage form. Vitamin D3 is the storage form. It is inactive. Then it is converted in liver to 25-hydroxy-D3 or calcidiol and biologically active 125-dihydroxy-D3, that is calcitriol, in kidney. Like hormones, the formation of both 25-hydroxy-D3 and 125-dihydroxy-D3 are subject to feedback inhibition. Like hormones, calcitriol has definite target organs like small intestine, bones and kidneys to act upon. That is, actually calcitriol is produced in one organ and it acts upon distant target organs like small intestine, bones and kidneys. It acts for its activity. Calcitriol resembles steroid hormone in its mode of action, that is nuclear action. Calcitriol maintains calcium homeostasis along with two other protein hormones, parathormone and calcitonin. Calcitriol maintains calcium homeostasis along with PTH and calcitonin. PTH is considered as a tropic hormone for calcitriol. It increases the calcitriol production by stimulating the enzyme 1-alpha-hydroxylase. Stimulates the production of 1-alpha-hydroxylase in kidney tubules. That is the mode of action of calcitriol. Next, we will see functions of vitamin D. Vitamin D acts on target organs like bones, kidneys, intestinal mucosa to regulate calcium and phosphate metabolism. First function is intestinal absorption of calcium and phosphate. Intestinal absorption of calcium and phosphate. The vitamin D binds to chromatin of target tissue and expresses the genes for calcium binding protein as well as calcium ATPase in intestinal cells. So, vitamin D binds to chromatin. Binds to chromatin of target tissue and expresses the genes for calcium binding protein as well as calcium ATPase in intestinal cells. Thus, it increases calcium absorption by actively transporting calcium across the plasma membrane against electrochemical gradients. That is the function in intestinal absorption of calcium and phosphate. Next function is mineralization of bones. This mineralization of bonds is promoted by 125-dihydroxy-D3 as well as 25-dihydroxy-D3. 125-dihydroxy-D3 and 24-25-dihydroxy-D3. The synthesis of calcium binding proteins like osteocalcin and ALP is promoted. The synthesis of calcium binding proteins like osteocalcin, then ALP, is promoted, which increases calcium and phosphate ions in the bone. These ions enhances the mineral deposition in the bone. Then this 24-25-dihydroxy-D3 helps the deposition of hydroxyapatite in bone. Vitamin D promotes bone resorption and calcium mobilization to raise the levels of calcium and phosphate in blood in association with PTH. That is the function in mineralization of bones. Next function is renal absorption of calcium and phosphate is also done by 125-dihydroxy-D3 in the similar way. Renal absorption of calcium and phosphate. Renal absorption of calcium and phosphate is also done by 125-dihydroxy-D3. Then it lowers the pH. It lowers the pH in certain parts of the gut, such as colon, and produces increase in urinary pH. lowers the pH. Lowers pH in certain parts of the gut such as colon and producers and increase in urinary pH. Then next function is it counteracts the inhibitory effect of calcium ions on the hydrolysis of phytate. In adequate amounts and in the case of high calcium intake, it suppresses the anti-calcifying effect of phytate. That is another function. Next one is, in physiologically compatible intake, it is found to increase the citrate content of bone, blood, tissues and urinary level. These are the functions of vitamin D. Next, we will see deficiency of vitamin D. Deficiency of vitamin D. First one is rickets. Actually, the deficiency produces rickets in growing children and osteomalacia in adults. We will see rickets. Vitamin D is required for the normal growth and mineralization of bones. In its absence, instead of growth occurring normally, the osteoblast proliferation does not take place in an orderly fashion. Thus, it is not accompanied by vascularization and mineralization at the normal rate. This results in irregularity in the zone of provisional calcification. The cartilage cells do not regenerate and ends of the long bones become bulky and soft. Then the bone mineral may be reabsorbed away from shaft of long bones and making it soft. Bending of long bones give rise to deformities such as bow legs, no knees. Bow legs, no knees. The ankles, knees and wrists, elbows are swollen due to swelling of epiphyseal cartilages. Ribs give beaded appearance. Beaded appearance. And chest give a pigeon breast appearance. Pigeon breast appearance. Then the teeth erupt late and are deformed. These are the characteristics of rickets. Then next we will see the types of rickets. Mainly two types are there. Type 1 and type 2. This type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is characterized inherited as autosomal recessive trait. It is characterized by defect in the conversion of 25-hydroxy-D3 to calcitriol. 25-hydroxy-D3 to calcitriol. Defect in the conversion of 25-hydroxy-D3 to calcitriol. That is 1-alpha-hydroxylase deficiency. 1-alpha-hydroxylase deficiency. That is type 1. In type 2, it is an autosomal recessive disorder in which there is a single amino acid change in one of the zinc fingers of DNA binding sites for receptors. This makes the receptors non-functional. That is type 2 rickets. Next, we will see osteomalacia. Next deficiency is osteomalacia. The deficiency of vitamin D in adults is osteomalacia, which is rare. It can occur in pregnancy and lactation where there is additional requirement of this vitamin and drainage of this vitamin in milk. It is seen in climates where sunshine is scanty, calcium and phosphorus absorption is decreased. Consequently, mineralization of osteoid to form bone is impaired. Such bones become soft. This particularly affects pelvic bones. Next deficiency is renal osteodystrophy. Renal osteodystrophy. When renal parenchyma is lost or diseased, it is unable to form calcitriol and calcium absorption is impaired. Hypocalcemia leads to increase in PTH. Hypocalcemia leads to increased PTH. Then which acts on bone to increase calcium. Increase calcium. Consequently, there is excessive bone turnover and structural changes. This condition is called osteodystrophy. That is the deficiency diseases. Next, we will see hypervitaminosis D. hypervitaminosis D. Normally, vitamin D is well tolerated if taken in large doses, but serious deleterious effects may be produced if taken in extremely large doses, that is 500 to 1000 times of normal requirement for prolonged periods. Effects are mainly due to induced hypercalcemia. Two types of effects are there, immediate effect and delayed effect. Immediate effect, delayed effect. Immediate effects include anorexia, thirst, lassitude, constipation, polyuria, nausea, omitting and diarrhea. In delayed effects, persistent hypercalcemia and hyperphosphatemia. It may produce urinary lithiasis, metastatic calcification, which may affect kidneys, bronchi, pulmonary alveoli, muscles, arteries and gastric mucosa. Renal failure may develop and can lead to death. In growing children, there may be excessive mineralization of the zone of provisional calcification at the expense of diaphysis, which may undergo demineralization. Certain clinical disorders are attributed to stages of hypervitaminosis D due to increased sensitivity to the vitamin. Certain clinical disorders, they are attributed to stages of hypervitaminosis D due to increased sensitivity to the vitamin, that is idiopathic hypercalcemia of children. Next one is Bakes sarcoidosis. So this is hypervitaminosis D. Next we will see the clinical aspects of vitamin D. Low vitamin D level is correlated with certain other diseases. First one is heart ailments. Individuals having vitamin D level below a certain level, that is below 15 mg per ml, have double the risk of developing heart problems in the form of either heart attack or stroke or heart failure. Individuals having vitamin D level below the certain level, that is 15 nanogram per ml, had double the risk of developing heart problems, either in the form of heart attack or stroke or heart failure. The vitamin D receptors are present in smooth muscles of heart and blood vessels. Vitamin D receptors are present in smooth muscles of heart and blood vessels. The presence of vitamin D causes these smooth muscles through vitamin D receptors to relax. And this in turn prevents heart attack or stroke. This is also the reason for the role of vitamin D in alleviating hypertension. Next one is in diabetes. Role of vitamin D in preventing diabetes. Ubiquitous vitamin D receptors are located in the beta cells of islet of Langerhans of pancreas. Ubiquitous vitamin D receptors. These receptors are present in beta cells of islets of Langerhans of pancreas. In insulin dependent type 1 diabetes, that is IDDM1, occurred commonly in areas which receive less sunlight. Vitamin D stimulates the release of insulin and the expression of insulin receptors. Low vitamin D levels may be a particular problem for children and teenagers to develop type 1 diabetes. Next one is in breast cancer. Maintaining optimal vitamin D levels may prevent certain types of cancers, particularly that of breast cancer. Breast cancer cells have vitamin D receptors. When these receptors are activated with vitamin D, it brings about some molecular reactions that can make the cancer cells slow down their growth rate or even die or at least become less aggressive. So breast cancer, it is maintaining the optimal vitamin D levels may prevent certain types of cancers. Next one is peripheral artery disease. Peripheral artery disease. Vitamin D protect against arterial disease in which fatty deposits restrict the blood flow to the limbs. Vitamin D protect against arterial disease. There, fatty deposits restrict blood flow to the limbs. People with low levels of vitamin D experience an increased risk of peripheral artery disease, most often reduces blood flow to the legs, causing pain, numbness, impairing the ability to work and in some cases leading to amputation. So this is about vitamin D, its clinical aspects. So this is today's topic. Thank you for watching.